This video is a tutorial for homework 5 BTree for COSC 2430 with Dr. Rizk.
Hello everyone, my name is Mohammed. I'll go over the homework number 5 for BTree. So for this video, I'll go over first the questions that are asked in the homework. Then I'll go over the BTree data structure. Then I'll go over the approach that we would take to implement the BTree data structure and how would we traverse it. Then I will go over the code for the main file, the main.cpp. And then I will go over the code for BTree class. And lastly, I will show you a debugger view of the BTree so you can visualize it. Now I'll go over the homework and the questions that are asked in this homework. So this homework asks us to implement the BTree data structure. Now, the input files are all just integer values that are separated by a new line or space, and they may be positive, so they're just going to give us a value that we need to insert in our BTree. Now, we have a command file that will tell us the degree of the BTree and also levels to print. And then we have obviously output file. Now this is how the input looks like. So we have all the numbers, we have the degree, and we have the level. So it's telling us to insert these numbers into the BTree of this degree. And after we have done that, it's asking us to print this level from the BTree. And in the output, we also have to output the height of the BTree. So we output the height of the BTree, then we output level 2 of the BTree. Similarly, in this example, we output we take all of these values and we make a BTree with it, and then we output the our BTree of degree 4, and then we output the height of that BTree, and then we output all these corresponding levels. And let's say if a level is empty, we would just print empty. Now I will briefly explain the BTree data structure. The BTree data structure is a nonlinear data structure. The BTree data structure has multiple values in each node. So it does, unlike normal binary search trees, it has an array or something in a node that stores multiple values. And we call those values keys. What this does is it improves lookup times for values. Now, how do we know how many values can be stored in a BTree? That's where the degree of the BTree comes in to play. The degree could be even or odd. It's a number that determines how many keys an iteration a BTree would have. The keys in a BTree node would be determined by degree minus 1, while the children in the BTree node would be equal to the degree. Now each time there is a value in a node or key, our children will be 1 plus that value. So let's say if we have 1 key in a node, we would have 2 children for that node. Now this is only true if the tree is not a loop node. Some other properties of BTree are the BTrees only grow upwards. So unlike normal trees, we only increase the height of the BTree when we have enough values so that we have to create a new root. So, and then nodes of a BTree are created when the root is split. So when we reach the maximum number of possible keys in the root, we would increase the height of the BTree by splitting the root and creating 2 new nodes. And also we'll create a new root. So in this situation, we are actually creating 2 new nodes. One new node by splitting our original root into 2 nodes, and another new node by creating a new root. New nodes are also created when the leaf of the BTree is split or some node in the middle is also split. Now let's look at some examples of BTree. We will visualize that using this tool. And we will look at an example of an odd degree BTree and an even degree BTree. First, we will look at a BTree of degree 3 and we will insert value from 1 to 7 in there. Two important things to keep in mind is whenever a node would have values, it cannot have values more than its capacity. So in case of a degree 3, the max value a node would have would be 2. So if it has 3 values, the node would be split and the middle value would be moved upward. Now, another important thing to keep in mind is we always insert the value in leaf nodes. So initially, our root node would be a leaf node, so we can insert the value in root node. But as our tree grows in height, our values would be inserted in the leaf node, so they would not be inserted in the root, and we'll have to go traverse to the leaf node, and then we can insert our values. So let's look at it. So first, we insert the value 1, then we insert the value 2. Now when we insert the value 3, we see that we will exceed the maximum capacity of this node. We will split this node and move the middle value up. Now let's see how that looks like. So as you can see, the middle value, which was 2, was moved to the new root, while these two became the children. So there were two nodes created. Keep this in mind. When a new root is created, we have two new nodes created. There was only one node before, but after this new root, we have a new root node, and we have another children node. There are three nodes in total. Before this, there was only one node. Now, we also get splits in nodes, or we create a new node, when we split a node that is in the middle or the bottom. But in those situations, we only create one new node. And we'll look at an example of that too. So let's insert the value 4. As you can see, initially we were inserting a value in the root. But since the root is not a leaf node anymore, we traverse to the leaf node and insert the value in its desired location. Now, we insert the value 5. But when we insert the value 5, this node would exceed its maximum capacity. We'll split this node and we'll send the value 4 upwards. Now, in this situation, we will create only one new node, which would be this one. This is different from when we created a new root, where we created two new nodes. And keep this in mind, because this would be important when writing the code for this section. Now, when we're inserting the value 6 in there, which we've inserted here. Now, what do you think would happen when we insert the value 7? Well, since value 7 would be inserted here, and this node would exceed its capacity, it would move this value up. However, when this value is inserted here, like the value 6, this node would exceed its capacity. So that value would be moved upward, and a new root would be created. Which means that insertion in B-trees are recursive. And let's see that in action. So we do a recursive approach when it comes to insertion. We have to constantly check if the values we have the node in which the value we have inserted the values has exceeded its capacity. If it has exceeded the capacity, then we split that node, and depending upon which kind of node it was, we'd create a new root or we just create new nodes. And there's always a connection between the parent and the children node. We have to keep these things in mind as we code. Now let's look at an example of an odd tree. Even tree. So this was an odd tree, right? And we were inserting the values. We were moving the middle value up because we were trying to divide the node in halves. But in case of an even tree, we would not be able to find the middle because there are two values in the middle. So the question is, which value would be moved up? Well, we move the value that is between the two values that are in the middle in case of an even tree, we move the first value up. So let's look at that example a bit. So we select the degree 4 and we insert the value 1. Then we insert the value 2 and then the value 3. Now we haven't exceeded the the maximum possible capacity where we reached it. So now when we insert the value 4, we would exceed the maximum possible capacity. And since this is a root node, we'll create a new root node. And as I said, in this situation, we would have two middle values, which would be 2 and 3. So the first one, which is 2, would be moved upward. The value 2 was moved upward to the new root, and node 1 was split into its own node, while another node was created, which had the value 3 and 4. Now keep this in mind, because this would be important, that the splitting of the nodes is different when the value, when the degree is even versus when the degree is odd. The middle value is different. We have to keep this in mind, and we have to implement our split function accordingly. Now we insert the value 5 in this BTree. And this value is moved here. As you can see, we're still inserting the values in the leaf. And we insert the value 6. Now this node will be split, and the value, the first middle value, will be moved upward. Now we keep inserting more values. As we insert 8, that node will be split, and the second middle value will move upward. Now, since this tree has a degree of 4, that means the maximum number of values we can have in the node is 3. And we have 3 values here, and the maximum number of children we can have is 4, and we have 4 children. So we insert one more value. Now, this is a similar situation as the odd BTree. When we insert the value 10 in here, we split this node and move the value 8 up. And when the value 8 is up, this node will exceed capacity, so we'll split this node and move the value 4 up. Okay, now another important thing to note here is I inserted all the values in these examples in an order made, right? So I inserted values from 1 to 10. But that may not be the case in the test cases you'll be given in the homework. They may be out of order. So always when you're inserting the values, always make sure that you're either inserting directly them in order by using insertion sort, or you're sorting them right after you're inserting the values. Now, let's look at the code for the main class for this homework. So first, I'll just go over the boilerplate code. So we have our normal argument manager stuff. We're taking in the input and the command file. And we also take in that output file in case when you're testing the homework. Now, we'll create a string. We get the value. The first thing we get is the degree of the BTree. So we parse it and we store it in an integer. Then we create a BTree and we write the class for this later. And we give it the degree. Now, after that, we create a key integer and we take in keys until we reach the end of the input file. Now, for this homework, it is important that we do not insert duplicates in our BTree. So first, we'll check if our BTree has any duplicates. So we'll call BTree.findKey and we'll pass in the key. Now, BTree.findKey would be a function that'll take the key and return whether it is true or false. Whether the key exists or not, it'll tell us. If the key does not exist, then we go about inserting the value. And then we'll call btree.insert node and insert the value. After we've inserted all the values in the btree, we call btree.traverse, which traverses the value. It first the entire BTree and give us the value. Now the homework also asks you to put in the values by level. For that situation, what you can do is you can pass in the OFS as you can pass in the OFS variable as a reference to this function, and you can pass in your desired level. And as you're doing the level order traversal, but you pass in the initial level as 1, and each time you traverse through the tree, you increment the level. Now, as you reach the desired level, you would push the value into the OFS variable. And once you're done traversing, you flush the value out to the output file. Now, after this, we'll look at the BTree class. Okay, now let's look at the BTree class. First, we'll look at the structure of the class, and then we'll also go over what variables we're going to have. And we're going to also go over what functions we're going to have and why we're going to have them. So first, we're going to go over the BTree node class. So each BTree would have node, and each of those nodes would have a class. Each node, I'll make all the variables public just for the sake of simplicity. So each node would have a Boolean value called leap. This would tell whether this node is leap or not. Each node would also have a vector, and we're going to use vectors in our example, in our implementation of BTree. Vector of integers called keys, which will store all the keys in the BTree. We'll also have a variable called size, which would store the size, which will tell us how many keys there are already in the BTree. Now, we have another variable, which would be a vector, which would store all the children. And since children would also be BTree nodes, this would be a pointer to BTree nodes. We'll call this children. Now, we're gonna have another BTree node, but this one would be important because this would be the parent node, and this would also be a pointer. We're gonna make sure that there's some way of connecting the child to the parent so it can easily traverse when we're getting the recursive split function. Now, when we're initializing a node, we'll pass in the parent, they'll also pass in whether that node is leap or not. So based off of that, we initialize the leap property as L. We'll resize the keys to 0. And the reason why we do this is so that we can see this in the debugger properly. We said that size of the BTree, size of the node, equal to 0 since there are no keys initially, and then set the children, and it will resize the children as 0 as well. And keep in mind, the resizing is only for the debugger. If you don't do this, that code would still work. I initialize the parent as the value that is given in the parameters. Now, let's look at the BTree class. And we would only have BTree node in the BTree. We would only have a constructor in this class. Now let's look at the BTree class. In the BTree class, we have two values. First, we will call the BTree node. Which we will call this will be a pointer to the root node. Then, and again, I'll make all the values public just for the simplicity's sake. But usually you would have these values as private, and you would have getters for each of these. Now, we would have another value that will store the degree of the tree. With an integer called tDegree, to store the degree of the tree. Now, let's look at the functions of the BTree. So I already wrote the definitions, so I will go through them one by one, just explaining what each function would be and why we need it. So first would be just a constructor, and the only thing we should really pass in the constructor is the degree of the BTree. So over here, the first passing the root. First, whenever we initialize the BTree, we want to make sure we allot some space for the root. So we'll initialize the root node, call it a new BTree node. And since we know that this is a really new node, and this would not have a parent, so we give it a null pointer. And this would be a root node, so it shouldn't have a parent. And then this would be a leaf node, so we would give it a value of true initially. Now, the degree, tree degree, would be equal to the given degree given us in the parameter. Now let's look at the definitions of other functions. Now let's look at the findKey function. The findKey function would take in a node, which would be the root node at the starting when it's called, and it would take the key we're looking for and return a boolean value whether that key exists or not. The first thing we would do in the findKey function is we declare an integer I, and this would represent the index of the key we're looking for. Then we start a while loop, and we iterate through the key and make sure that we do not reach to the index is less than node dot size. And the reason for this is because the highest possible index is 1 minus size. We want to make sure we only reach the highest possible index. Now, we also want to make sure that we only iterate until our key, which is k, is greater than the current value we are at. So, and the reason for this is because we want to keep iterating until we reach a value in the keys array that is either equal to or greater than our key. Now, once we reach that value, we have to check whether it is equal or not, or whether it's greater. So we will do this check again here. And the reason why we do this check again here is because sometimes our node may not have any values at all. So just to avoid null pointer exception, we make sure that we have not reached a value that is greater than the size. And we're not trying to access an unallocated memory. Now, what we will do is we will check if key is equal to our current node value. If that is the case, we have found the key. So all we do is return true. If that is not the case, we check if this node is a leaf node, because that would be important. Because after this, if we have not found the value, we have two options. If we have not found the value in current node, we have two options. We either go look in the child of that node to see if the value exists there, or we either stop. Now, if this node is a leaf node, then that means it would not have any children. That means we've searched the tree and we have not found the value, so we return false. But if it's not a leaf node, we return a function. So we will recursively call the findKey function and then pass in the node, the children, that is right after this key, because that children might contain the key. Right after the current value of our key, that is the right after the value, the key value that is greater than our target key. So we pass, we traverse that children and pass in the key as well. Now let's look at the traverse function. So the traverse function would just traverse the tree, and it would do it in a breadth first search manner. So it would go down deep the tree, it would come up, and then it would go to the next node, it would go down deep that node. Now, let's look at how we would implement it. First, we would check whether the node is empty, so whether it is null pointer or not. If it is, we don't do any traversal, just return. Now, if it is not null pointer, we check if the tree is what we would do is we start traversing the tree first. So we start with 0, and we go all the way, and when we are traversing the tree for each node, we would traverse its the keys in its node. So for this current node, we traverse each of the keys. So we would go from 0th key all the way to the size of the node, which is the last key, right? One less than the size, and we go, and as we are going through it, we'll check first if this node is a leaf node or not. So we'll check if it's not a leaf node, because that is important. Because if it is, should check leaf. So leaf, and if it is a leaf node, then we need to first insert its, we need to traverse its child. So we will call the traverse function again and pass in the child of that node. Because we want to traverse each of the children first before we traverse the actual value itself. So we will pass in the level. Now the level initially would be 1 if we don't pass in, but since when we go down to the children, we want to increment the level, so we will go level plus 1. Now after we have incremented the child, right, we will traverse the value, and just to show the traversal, I'll just see out it. So we'll see out the value, and we will do keys, we'll do node, keys, I, and we'll also show the level, which would be level, and that's it. Now, after we have traversed all the keys and the children that come before them, we wouldn't be done with the traversal. The reason being is the number of children is always one more than the key. So even though we have traversed children and keys, we still have one last children left. So for that, we'll do the same process. We pretty much copy this statement here and repeat it one more time here, and we'll check whether it's not a leaf node. If it's not a leaf node, we're going to traverse the children, and as you can see, it's giving us an error here. So in order to resolve this error, what we would do is we would initialize I here instead. So that should solve the issue. Right. So that this function would help us traverse the tree. And as you are going through the example for the homework, you might also be asked to traverse the tree and output the value based on a particular level given. So for that, what you can also do is you can have another integer called int target level, right, and you would have the OF stream OFS, and you would have OFS, you would have a like a reference to an OFS variable, and you have a target level, and it would check whether the level you're at over here, if it's equal to your target level. So level, if level is equal to your target level, and if that is the case, you would do OFS dot your value, right? So whatever your value would be. This would allow you to put in all your values based off the level. Now, once you're done, after calling this function traverse using these parameters in your main class, you would write a piece of code that did OFS.flush. And that should allow you to output the values for this homework. But just for the sake of simplicity, I'm going to take it out in this example. Now, let's look at the insert node and the insert key function. So, you might be wondering why I have two functions for inserting. Well, for the first function, insert node, would actually find the right node where we have to insert the value. So remember, we're never inserting the values in the root of the middle node. We are always inserting the values in the leaf. And we are also inserting the keys. Now, sometimes we would move the values up. So that's where the insert key function comes in, because it just inserts the key, but it doesn't insert the value, because this function would only insert the values in the leaf node. But this may insert values on any node, because it doesn't know where it's being called from. Now, this function would also check whether the node has exceeded its maximum capacity. So now, let's look at the insert node function. The first thing we would do in insert node function is we will check if our currently passed node is a leaf node. Since this function just is used to traverse the tree so that we can get to our desired node, if we reached a leaf node, that means we have reached our desired node if we only insert in the leaf node. So if we have reached the leaf node, all we do is we call the insert key function, which would actually do the insertion. We pass it the node and also the key. Now, So now, if that's not the case, we want to keep traversing the tree. And over here, we will do a similar logic as we did in our findKey function. We would have an index, and which would start at 0. And we will keep traversing until we are less than the size, so we have not reached the last index, and our current value, our current key, is greater than our node key, current key in our node. And until then, we'll keep incrementing. Now, after we have reached a desired position where the key is actually less than or equal to, shouldn't be equal to, because we are always checking whether the key exists or not. So if the key exists, we wouldn't be able to insert, so it'll be only less than, right? So once we find that our key would be less, we would do insert node, and we would recursively call this function and pass in that child. We pass in the child, and we also pass in the key, because this part would actually allow us to keep traversing the tree. And using this technique, we are traversing in a way so that since in each node our values are ordered from smallest to largest, to get to the value where whose children would actually have the new value inserted to them. We go all the way to that particular children, and then we traverse towards that children, and we keep doing that until we reach a children that is actually a leaf node, and that's where we insert the value. Now let's look at the insert key function. The insert key function would do the actual insertion of the key, which means that we'll take the node, and we'll take the keys array, and we'll actually push back the value. We push back the key, and then we call the sort function. So the sort function would actually sort the keys. And the reason why we need to do this is because our, like I said in our visualization example, that our node, our values may not be in order fashion. So if that's the case, we need to always sort the values when we're inserting the new values. After we have sorted the values, we would increase the size of the node. And finally, after we increase the size of the node, we will check if the node has exceeded its capacity. Because if that's the case, we must split the node. And now we would check the size, and a node would have exceeded its capacity if its size is equal to the degree of the tree. So we'll check if the node size is equal to the tree degree, then it's exceeded its capacity, because the values that can have in the node, the maximum number of values we can have in the node should be equal to 1 less the degree. So if it's equal to the degree, then we have exceeded the capacity. So now we'll call the split node function, and then we will also call we'll also give it the value of the node we want to split, and we'll give it we'll just give it the value of the node. Now split node is the heaviest function in this entire class, because this function by itself would take care of a lot of stuff for the BTree. Depending upon what node we pass into it, it would split the node, it would create new nodes, it would connect the nodes properly to each other, and it also account for the fact whether the degree of the tree is even or not. Alright, now let's look at the split node function. This would be the biggest function in the entire class, so let's go through its load. First, we know that whenever we're splitting a node, we will always create a new node. We might create one new node, or we might create two new nodes. But we know that our minimum number of new nodes would be one. So we create that first. Create a BTree new node, we call it left. It could be a pointer node. And create a new BTree node. So this node would be the sibling node of the node we are passing in. It would have the same properties as that node. So its parent should be the same as the node's parent, and it should also have the same property of leaf as the node. So if the node is a leaf node, then this should also be a leaf node. If node is not a leaf node, it shouldn't be a leaf node. And that is leaf. Okay, now we'll determine the size of this node. This is something that depends on whether the degree of this tree is even or odd. Remember in our example for the visualization of BTree, whenever the degree of the tree was odd, we were splitting it down the middle and removing the value up. So both the new nodes that were created, general nodes, were always the same size. While in the example of the even one, the left node was smaller than the right node by one value. So we'll keep that in mind while we're writing this part. So first, we'll check whether the degree of the tree is even or odd. So now, the way we would do that is we take the 2 degree, we check it if the modulus is 0, and this tells us that it's an even degree. Now if it's an even degree, we know that the size, so we'll define the size. So what we would do is we would define a variable called size right here. Right. Okay. Hold on. Okay. Now, so we define a variable called size, and we will check whether the size variable. We'll check whether the node, the tree has a degree of even or odd. So if the degree is even, the size variable should be 2 degree divided by 2, since this would have half the values, right? And if it's even, it would have half the values, but 1 minus that, because it's one, right? So we'll take the do the half of the degree, and we'll subtract one from it. So, for example, let's say if the degree was 4, right? If the degree was 4, right? So if the degree was 4, we would only want, if the degree was 4, then we would only want one value in our left node. So our left node would have only one value, while our right node would have two values. And the middle value, which we had second position, would go up, right? So this would be the size of our left node, which would be 4 divided by 2, which would be 2 minus 1, which would be 1 in this scenario. Now, let's say if that's not the case and the degree is odd, what we'll do is the size would be 2 degree divided by 2. Okay. Now, that is the left node. For the right node, and in this example, for example, let's say if the degree was odd, right, our left node would have one value, while our right node would also have one value. Okay, so now this is for the left node. Since left node left node is done differently, right? So when we do divide by 2 here, we get 1 for this, right? Since here, if we divide by 2, we get 2 for this. And we want to make it one less. Well, in this situation, once we get 1, we already have the desired value. But for the right node, if you look at, in this situation, even though the values are different, the actual normal division would give us the right value for the right node. Right? So in this situation, it gives us 1, which is right. In this situation, it gives us 2, which is right. So the only thing we have to worry about is the left node value, and we do a subtract for that. So for the right node, later on this code, we will just do 2 degree divided by 2 for both nodes. So now we have determined the size. Based on the size, we take out that many values from this node and we put them in our newly created left node. So we go from 0 to that size. And we'll go to our left node. And it'll add in values to that keys array, and we'll add in values from our node. Zero. So we'll add the first value. Now this might sound weird, but I'm adding the first value. The reason being is because I want to add the first value. And then I'm going to remove this first value from here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do an auto iterator. And that auto iterator would be node keys dot begin. Okay. And then we pass in this iterator to the arrays function. So we do erase, that's it. So now this will remove the first value. So we added the first value, and then we added the first value to the left node, and we removed it from the node. Now, we want to keep doing that until the size. So that's how many values we remove. Now, after we removed all our desired values, we would hit the value that we need to push up. For example, in this scenario, we remove one value and we hit the value which we have to push up. And in this situation, we have the same thing, right? So we want to store that value somewhere. So we call it key pushed. And we'll store it in a variable called key pushed. And that value would be the first value in the node. And again, gonna make sure that we remove this value from the node because it shouldn't exist in the node. So we copy the same logic here. Now, depending upon whether this node is a child node or not, you might also want to copy the children, because the sum of the children would also be split. So what we would do is we will first check whether the node we are splitting is leaf or not. Okay. Let's say it is leaf node, then we have to copy the children. So we pretty much follow the same logic, so I would not rewrite it, I would just copy it. And I'll just do some changes in here. Okay. So now we always know that whenever we're copying the keys are one more. So, or not the keys, my bad. Whenever we're copying the children are always one more. So we will always go one more. And then, since we are copying the children, we go children. And we'll also go children here as well. Now, before we move on, an important thing we would want to do is before we move on and we remove the children from this node, right? What we would want to do is we would also want to set the parent property. So since we're moving the children from this node, so we're giving the children of this node to the left node, we also want to make sure that the children of this node that are going to the left node also know that their parent is now left node. So what we would do is we go left node, not children, and the children we have inserted, go to that children, and we'll check its parent property, and we'll make it equal to left. So this sounds weird, but what we're essentially here doing is we're going to that particular children and we're telling it, hey, your parent is left now. So after we've done that, we again create an iterator because we have inserted the first value, and we remove that value, but this time from children. Now we have done that. So we have copied, we have figured out the size base of whether it's even or not. We have copied our keys. We have saved the key we need to push up. And we have also copied the children. We have to do one more thing before we go about creating more new nodes. And that is, we have to decrease the size of our node that we were splitting. So we go node size, and we just do it T degree divided by 2. And this is now this node, and you can change the name here. You can call it right if you want, so that it's more clear. But this node would be our right node, right? So this is the size of right node. And as you can see in here, when we do 4 divided by 2, in the case of an even, it'll be 2s, and in the case of an odd, it'll be 1. So we don't need to do any minus or any of that stuff here. So it's just to divide. It would work in both cases. Now, here's the important part of this function, or at least the difficult part, right? So we have to first check whether this is a root node or not. Because remember from our example in the visualization, whenever it's a root node, we don't just create one new node, we create 2 new nodes. So you have to check for that. So we check, and the way we would do that is we check the node, and check its parent. And check whether it's equal to null pointer, because root is the only node that would have a parent of null pointer. And if that is the case, then we have reached a node that is a root node. And we're trying to split a root node. So what we would do is we would create a new root node, right? And we have already split the node, but that is one node, right? We created a left sibling, but we also want to create a new parent node, which would be the new root. So we create that, and this is the only situation where we create 2 new nodes when we are splitting the root. If we are not splitting the root, we only create one new node. We call it new root. a new BTree node, and we pass in the value. Now, in this example, we're passing the null pointer because the root shouldn't have a parent, and we're passing the value false here. Now, let's look at what this value was. This value was the representation of whether this node is a leaf node or not. So we said it's false. And the reason why we said it's false is every time the tree grows, the new root is not the leaf anymore. So this would set our tree for the right property for each coming node. And whenever we split node, any nodes that come from this would also not be the leaf nodes. So the only nodes that would be the leaf nodes are the ones that are created at the bottom. Okay, so now we, okay, so hold on, let me finish this. Okay, so after we created a new root node, we would insert the values in the insert the values in there. So we insert the first children there. So we do children dot push back, and we push back our left node in there. And as we're inserting the left node, we also have to let this new root know. We also have to let left know, hey, your parent is this new root. So it's a new root dot children 0 dot parent equal to new root. Right? And we're going to repeat the same process. So, but this time for our node, which is basically our right node. But this time, instead of 0, we call 1 because this is the second node. So we're making two children for this new root, which would be our left and right node. And then after we've done this, we'll pass in the new value to this root node. So the new root node, I'm passing the key, push back key, and we know that this key we saved earlier was called key push, so we push that key, and then finally we increment the size of this this root node. And one last thing we have to also do here is we have to set the root equal to the root, which is basically the root we had from our BTree. So since we create a new root, we have to make sure that the root is updated. So the root would be equal to new root. Okay, so that should create a new root. So here you can see we create one node here and we create another. And this is only happens when we have a new root. Now let's say we don't have a new root. In that situation, we are splitting a node that is not root. That means it's a node in the middle or it's a node at the bottom, which is a leaf node. So the first thing we have to do is we have to find an iterator to the node, right? So the node we are splitting. So in order to do that, I'll first just create create a variable that would store the parent of this node. So I call a BTree pointer, call it parent, and I call it node parent. This way we would have to write less code. Now I call it an iterator, and this iterator would be parent.children dot find, and it would take parent dot begin, also take current dot end, and lastly we'll take the node. Now this might sound weird, but okay, over here we would actually we'll be fine. Okay, that's there. And this would be a dot. Okay, cool. Now this might sound weird, and but the reason why we are doing this is because we are trying to get the iterator to the node itself that we are trying to split. And once we get the iterator to that node, we're going to use it to insert our let node. So that's why we are doing this. And hold on, why is it getting the error? Well, okay, so I just copied this. There was some error in my writing, but this should work. Okay, so now once we have this iterator, what we want to do is we want to do we don't want to insert our left in this parent, because this is just a pointer. We want to go to node, and we're going to do a parent. We want to say, okay, parent, here, give me your children, and from your children, I want to call insert function. And in the insert function, I want you to insert left. I want you to insert left in this place. Alright, so what this is going to do is it's going to take all the children in this parent node of the current node that we are about to split, and it's going to move all those children to the right, and it's going to create room for the left. So this would include the node itself, right? And it create the room for the left, and it will insert the left in there. So this is the benefit of using vectors, because you don't have to do this manually. If you're using dynamic threads, you have to do this manually. After we have done that, now we are not sure that after inserting this, we inserted the children, we are not done yet, right? So we want to also insert the key to the parent, right? So what we're going to do is we're going to do insert key. So insert key, and we're going to pass it the node's parent. So we're going to pass it the parent, and once we pass it the parent, we're going to also pass it the key to be pushed. And yeah. But one thing I forgot to do here is, before you push in the left, you also want to set the parent of the left. So left dot parent would be, actually never mind, we already did this before. We already do this, the account for this right here. So we don't have to do this. Okay, so once we call the insert key would do is, so let's say we insert the value, and the value, we create two nodes, and we split it and everything, and we insert the value, and the value goes to the parent, and the new value goes to the parent, right? And it's being inserted in the parent, and the parent also exceeds its value. So it would call this function again, and it would do the same thing again, and it would insert it to its parent, and if that also exceeds the size, and it will keep calling them until it reaches the root, and it will stop. So these two functions calling, they call each other recursively until we reach our, either we reach a point where the size is not being exceeded, or either until we reach the root itself. And this ensures that the BTree only grows vertically in height. Alright, let's look at a visualization of the BTree through the debugger. So I wrote an input and command file. The input file has values from 1 to 7, and the command file tells that this will be a BTree of degree 3. So first, you insert the values 1 and 2, right? So we'll do that here as well. And we can see the values 1 and 2 were inserted in our program. And this is how the BTree looks right now. Now, when we insert the value 3, so the current value that is to be inserted is 3, our BTree would split, right? And we have a new root. So let's do that. We'll insert the value 3. As you can see, our BTree was split, and we have a new value. And we can visualize this through the debugger. This is our root, and we have our values, and this is our root with the key 2, and we have the children. And we have two children. First children has a value 1. And the second children should have the value 3. Alright. Now, and this is really helpful in visualization. Now we keep inserting the values. So we insert 4. We insert 5. And we see the root splitting. We see the same here, and we insert 6, we insert 7, and we see the values. So we see our, we create a new level. So when we insert 7, we would actually create a new level. And as you can see, there were two levels, and we create a new level with the value 4. As you can see, these two are equivalent. And this is an example of an odd BTree. Now let's look at an example of an even BTree. So in this example, we have a BTree of degree 4. We insert some values in there. Now when we insert 4, our value is split and we get a new node. So we insert 1, 2, 3. Now 4 will create a new level. So it does. And we can do a similar thing. We can visualize these values through here. You can see that we have two children. And our second children should have two values. Alright. Now we keep inserting more values, so we insert 5, 6, which will split up our node, 7, 8, which would move the value up, 9, and lastly 10. Now 10 is important. When we insert 10, it will move this value up, and it will move the other value up, so it will increase the height of the root tree. So now we will do this here. So we insert 5, insert 6, we insert 7, insert 8, we insert 9, and finally we insert 10. But when we insert 10, the height of the tree would increase. And yes, the height of the tree increased. So that was the BTree homework. Now to finally show that the code I wrote actually works with the test cases, given by the homework, I'll run the test. Test 5, 9.sh. And voila!